Hello, everybody. Welcome to Smith College on this balmy day outside. Sometimes we have to introduce these things and say, you know, it's so wonderful that you all came from that beautiful sunshiny day out of that to come and listen to our talk. But I know the warmth will draw you as well as the talk. Professor Hughes is a first speaker in our series this semester. A lot of you were here last semester when we pursued discussions about meditation and mindfulness, particularly in the context of both the Burmese origins of the mindfulness traditions, but especially the way they kind of flourish here in the West through a lot of things that came out of Massachusetts, right? And we talked about those kinds of things, and we moved a little bit into sort of neuroscience areas towards the end of the series. And so this semester, in this series, which is titled, I believe, Cyborg Buddha and New Technologies of Awareness. There's an app for that. To me, this is kind of a natural move and extension of the kind of things we were doing last semester. As I've sat here in the Valley or in the field of Buddhist studies and in the West and watched the emerging excitement about neuroscience and all of the things that are happening in that area, and particularly, again, here in the Valley, the coming together of Buddhism and psychology, neuroscience, and all of those kinds of things, it's always seemed to me that we're moving in very interesting directions, and directions which Dr. Hughes has been pursuing for a long time. And I'm just going to sort of simply talk about or say technologies that include enhancement of not just our physical but also our mental well-being. And there's lots of ways that we can enhance ourselves. So this semester's speaker series is kind of following those kinds of trajectories, looking at the ways both theoretically as well as practically. Some of the speakers that are coming up are CEOs of companies, a little bit more Hollywood than Harvard, perhaps, a few of our speakers. And sort of looking at the ways that people are developing technologies that are able to enhance our well-being. And so our first speaker, Dr. Hughes, is at the forefront of this kind of conversation, and particularly interesting is that he comes from a very strong background in ethics and talking about sort of the ethical ramifications of this kind of enhancement, discussions that I'm learning are fraught with all kinds of interesting difficulties as well as promises. Dr. Hughes got his PhD out of Chicago in the field of sociology. He's had a lot of interesting pursuits since that time, including time as a monk in Sri Lanka. Here we have him. You can see he still looks the same. Most of us have less hair as we get older. I don't understand. He's kind of going the other way. Is this artificial enhancement going on here?
Rubbing the right chemical.
Spending time as a monk, and more recently, he's been down the road at Trinity in an administrative position, directing their Office of Institutional Research. He also is the director of the Institute for Ethics and Emerging Technologies. They have a website you can find very easily. It's filled with totally fun stuff. Every time I go there, there's more interesting and great things. Lots of podcasts, lots of interviews. I believe I did an interview with you once some time ago. At the very first, we had a New Technologies of Awareness symposium a number of years ago. This is actually the second in that area. Anyways, it's a very wonderful website. I was just out there a few minutes ago and discovered South Park episodes on Alan Watts, which I didn't even know existed. So I highly recommend the website to you if you're interested in these kinds of things. There's lots of great and interesting information out there. Dr. Hughes has been doing lots of work in this area. He's published extensively on these kinds of topics, lots of articles and lots of other kinds of representing of this sort of area. He has two books on the topic. The first one in 2004, Citizen Cyborg: Why Democratic Societies Must Respond to the Redesigned Human of the Future. And not quite out yet, but almost out, his new one, somewhat similar to his talk today, Cyborg Buddha, Using Neurotechnology to Become Better People. Thank you. Let's give him a warm welcome. All right. And as always, should you not have had this ubiquitous sign up, if you're interested in more of this, not just from, we do a lot of things here at Smith, but also in the Valley generally, Amherst College in Mount Holyoke, UMass, Hampshire. There's lots of very interesting things that are going on, almost too many for most of us to attend. But we do maintain a mailing list and send out things. So if you're interested in that and not and are not yet on this list, please do sign up, okay? Thanks. Thank you.
True. So 30 years ago, after I ordained as a monk and worked and lived for a while in Japan, my initial aspiration then was to become a Buddhist scholar, and I realized I didn't have the chops to master two or three archaic languages and do that. And so in graduate school, I drifted into bioethics and sociology, which eventually led me to questions around personhood, things that were philosophically cognate with Buddhism, and got very excited about the converging and emerging technologies that were going to be radically changing the human condition. Here's one example, the hippocampus chip that's been developed. DARPA is now doing research to develop this chip so that soldiers who have severe brain injuries can repair their hippocampus and thereby their memory. And the converging, accelerating convergence of all of these technologies is posing many, many questions about how we will be able to enhance or change or control aspects of intelligence, memory, and motion, and other parts of human experience. And I wrote this book now 10 years ago called Citizen Cyborg, called about why democratic societies really had to take these questions seriously about the challenges around who was going to be a citizen, who was going to have rights, what kind of how rights would be changed by these technologies. And my general argument in the book was that we would all be happier. I was very influenced by John Stuart Mill. Even though I've been Buddhist all along, I always thought that John Stuart Mill and the Buddha were basically two peas in a pod. They were both about the happiness of all sentient beings. And so I argued in Citizen Cyborg that the greatest good for the greatest number, the greatest happiness for the greatest number, would be maximized if we all had more control over our bodies and over our brains. And we had that control democratically as well. And so I argued explicitly in the book for a kind of Buddha-Millian utilitarianism without interrogating what I meant by happiness too much. But after that book, I started to work on this book, Cyborg Buddha, and I began to teach a course at Trinity on happiness. And that whole kind of blasé or naive notion of the of a unitary concept of what happiness was, which should have been deconstructed for me before, began to fall apart, and I began to interrogate that idea more clearly. Now, one of the reasons why I had argued that Buddhism was utilitarian was, at my naive younger self, I saw the opposite argument, the idea of virtue ethics or Buddhism being more similar to Aristotle, as being a conservative Catholic idea. Damien Keown is a Buddhist scholar who had argued that case, and he and I had argued a little bit over this case. And I pointed to things like Milarepa, the Buddhist scholar Milarepa, who one famous story says Milarepa was found lying in a river biting the heads off a fish. And the surprised layperson says, "What are you doing? You're not supposed to be killing sentient beings." And he says, "Well, I can look at each fish and figure out if it's going to have a better rebirth or a worse rebirth. And the ones that are going to have a better rebirth, I kill that one, and it gets to be reborn as a human being or something." So that's called consequentialism. You know, you can say, forget the rules. Once you're enlightened enough, you can forget the rules. You can do what you want as long as it has the right consequences. Well, that sounds a lot like utilitarianism. And I had argued this case and dismissed virtue ethics. And as I began to interrogate Buddhism more and happiness more, I began to realize that Buddhism is actually much more complicated in its ethical formulation, that it starts as what we call karmic ethics, that it starts as the ethics of self, that you're trying to figure out how can I make myself happy, how can I end my suffering, what kinds of actions do I need to do that, and especially not to end up in a hell realm. And then it moves on from there to character development, which is what Damien was arguing the case for, that Buddhism in that sense is very similar to Aristotle's ideas of development of character. eventually you get to the point where you're so cleansed of all your impurities that you are working for the sentient benefit of all sentient beings. And then, yes, maybe then you can bite the heads off a fish. But there's that big interstices where you have to be working on your character to get there. And so virtue ethics began to make a lot of sense to me in terms of how I was structuring this project. And it made sense in a second respect, which is that as I began to interrogate what it meant for this kind of radical neurotechnological future to have happiness as the summa bonum, as the greatest good, well, eventually we might all have wires in our heads or little neurological pharmaceutical systems in our heads where we can just push a button and have as much bliss as we want. And you've probably seen that this was done 30, 40 years ago with rats. You know, you just put a wire in their head, turn on their pleasure centers, and they just keep pushing that lever and they starve to death. And that has a kind of intrinsic revulsion to that as being the summum bonum, that we would all just do that and lie in the gutter and not care about anything else. And that revulsion that we feel is precisely the point that Aristotle and the other virtue theorists are getting at. There's more to life than pleasure. There's more to life than simple happiness of that hedonic sort. There's this concept of flourishing, some kind of dynamic engagement with life that is more important than that pleasurable idea. And what I didn't see, especially in the most articulate exponent within the futurist milieu that I work, David Pierce's hedonistic imperative, he's a utilitarian philosopher, and he argued because the end of suffering and the creation of the greatest pleasure should be our goal, we need to figure out how to create the safest drugs that maximize pleasure, we need to get people those wires in their heads, and he didn't see any distinction between flourishing, this kind of Aristotelian notion of flourishing, or as Owen Flanagan puts it, eudaimonia Buddha, eudaimonia being the Aristotelian term for what it means to have a flourishing happiness as opposed to just hedonic happiness. We were driving up and we were talking about this. Chris, my aide-de-camp, is not a Buddhist, but Chelsea is a Buddhist. So we started to talk about this and Chelsea said, well, you have to be worried about the God realms. Yes, exactly, Chelsea. This is the problem. Within Buddhist cosmology, there's this idea that you are caught in this cycle of reincarnation. I don't believe in reincarnation, but it's metaphorically very interesting to think about what it means that we very rarely end up, according to Buddhist cosmology, in the human realm where it's possible to practice the Dharma. And most of the time we spend either in the hell realm where we're so suffering all the time that we can't practice the Dharma, or the hungry ghosts where we're consumed by hunger, or the animal realm where we're too stupid, or the demigod realm where we're consumed by envy, the Kardashian realm, or the heavenly realm where we're consumed by pleasure. And when we end up in the heavenly realm, we live there for tens of thousands of years with pleasure. And so this time that we spend in the human realm is so precious, according to the Buddhist idea here. And the distinction there is between the heavenly realms, which are a trap, and Buddha lands, which is a Mahayana concept, but I'll get to a Theravadan interpretation of it in a second. Buddha lands are lands created by bodhisattvas for people to be reborn into that are perfect utopian paradises. But they're not utopian paradises of pleasure. They're utopian paradises that encourage us on the path of the Dharma, that take care of our material needs, that where we don't have to work, we're not tormented by oppressive tyrants, et cetera, but they support the practice of the Dharma. They don't consume us with pleasure. Okay, so for within the Buddhist cosmology, there's this very clear distinction between the creation of a eudaimonic situation and the creation of a pleasurable situation. I wrote a lot about when I was a young monk was Buddhist eschatology. And there's this wonderful sutra, the lion's roar of the wheel-turning emperor. I saw that you had written some things about this as well. In this eschatological vision that the Buddha very briefly talks about what's going to happen in the lead up to the coming of the next Buddha. There's a terrible war, but we'll pass over that quickly. Eventually, we begin to live longer and longer lives, and we live longer and longer lives because we are virtuous. And eventually, we are living 80,000-year lives. People don't get married until they're 500 years old. All our material wants are taken care of. There are wish-fulfilling trees that give us anything we want. All of the plants grow without having to be tended in any way. Then a righteous world monarch conquers the world peacefully, and then the government becomes unnecessary and the government dissolves and we just have an anarchist paradise. This Buddhist eschatology for me kind of represented this kind of secular version, or kind of the social gospel version, as opposed to the Mahayana version, which is that you have to pray to Amitabha Buddha, and eventually after you die, you might get to the paradise. But this is the kind of version that we, through our own efforts, might be able to create a society that supports collective virtue and the possibility of collective happiness. The problem, however, is that we are weak. We are too weak for the most part. And as I said, within Buddhist cosmology, there's this recognition that if you end up as an animal, you know, there's no point in spreading the, I mean, there's some bodhisattvas who try, bodhisattvas who preach in the hells, but there's no point really in preaching in the hells or to the animals because they're too consumed by their impediments to practice the Dharma. We live on that kind of bell curve. There are some of us on the end of the bell curve where we're born with depression, and some of us where we're born with mania. There are some of us where we're born with cognitive impairments and some at the other end, et cetera. It's very difficult for us to practice the Dharma, however we define that. And even within Buddhism, there's this recognition. I mean, the Buddhism is a religion where one third of the doctrinal corpus is psychological texts that are lists of mental constituent elements and descriptions of the different kinds of personalities and prescriptions about how different kinds of personalities have to practice different kinds of meditations in order to overcome their specific impediments. So if you're consumed by greed, you should practice meditations that allow you to overcome covetousness. So for instance, practicing a meditation in a charnel ground to reflect on the decomposition of the body and reflect on the impermanence of life and that why be obsessed about possessions. Or if you're consumed with hatred, practice loving kindness meditation. These are reflections that Buddhism recognizes that we are born with different personalities and we have different impediments. Now, at the time, there wasn't much to do about those impediments, but what this talk is about is what we can now do about some of those impediments. Just want to also reference this idea, situationism, which is that we're also weak in a second respect, and that is that philosophers of psychology are now looking at this question of virtue and they're interrogating it and they're saying, is there any evidence that there are people who have a virtue like steadfast compassion that is invariant across situations? If you put them in Abu Ghraib, are they still compassionate? Or do the social circumstances of certain normative constraints overwhelm our personalities in those situations? And they do. There's substantial evidence that they do. We have, even those of us who are working to be good people, to have substantial character, it's very difficult for us to do so. We began to realize that moral capacity was neurological a long time ago. This is Phineas Gage, who was a railway worker. He had an accident that blew a pole through his head, and very unlikely he survived this brain injury. And after he was a very reasonable guy before this injury, but after this injury he's described as fitful, irreverent, indulging at times in the grossest profanity, manifesting little deference for his fellows, impatient of restraint, and so forth. We've known for 150 years of the development of neurology that there is a neurological basis for our capacity for moral behavior, moral cognition, moral sentiments. And what this is leading to now is a debate within bioethics about the possibility that we would take this knowledge and apply it to enhancing those moral capacities, first by treating the most severe moral deficits, treating psychopathy and other kinds of moral deficits, but then also creating the possibility that we could have an even higher standard, collective standard, of what our moral capacities are that we could enable ourselves to through neurological intervention. Now this is John Harris, and this is Julian Savulescu, two British bioethicists who've kind of been battling this ping pong back and forth for the last 5-6 years. And they're coming out of the utilitarian tradition, as I was. And for them, the Savulescu has been arguing the case that what we really need to do is give everybody oxytocin, jack up their empathy, the cuddle hormone, And if everybody had a little bit more empathy, then they would, everybody would be nicer. And John Harris is saying, no, that would just make people into moral robots. What we really need to do is give everybody Ritalin, make them all smarter. And if we did that, then everyone would understand the good and be able to do it with moral reasoning better. So it's like, hello, let's take a step back. There have been people for 2,500 years talking about the virtues and how these virtues interact and balance one another and temper one another, and how reason and wisdom is good applied to compassion, and compassion is good applied to reason, and so on and so forth. Within the Buddhist tradition, this is a very important dialogue. So I've been trying to intervene in this debate on the side of a multi-virtue framework for moral enhancement, and I don't usually bring out the Buddhism to, and so this is a wonderful opportunity to bring out the Buddhism part of it. They're not impressed by Buddhism at all in the British at Oxford or Cambridge. The Buddhism part of it, for me, there's a great compatibility between Buddhism and the enhancement argument. In the first place, because Buddhism is not fatalistic or Luddite. The argument of Buddhism is that that technology is okay if we use it skillfully. Then the question is, how do we know when do we use it skillfully? We'll get to that. But the second reason that there's a great compatibility is the Hindu Buddhist worldview or cosmology. It's the greatest science fiction story ever told. I mean, it's billions of years long. There's people flying around on flying saucers or multiple planets with green bodies and multiple arms, and they're zapping you with their laser beams, and they're opening your mind, and suddenly their bodies turn into 1,000 things or 1,000 arms sprout out of their bodies. It's a lot of science fiction going on in this worldview. And in this worldview, there is no problem with human beings evolving from being human into being post-human, into being more than human, into being godlike. In fact, that's the whole point, right? For the Abrahamic tradition, we were created 5,000 years ago. Something's going to happen in the next couple hundred years where it's all going to end. When we get to that point, God expects us to look exactly the way we were when we started. And if we don't, if we have six arms or five heads, then things are going to really be in trouble. And so for the Abrahamic tradition, it's a huge problem, this idea of biological enhancement, because it seems like we're doing something very unnatural. Not a problem. When you ask people from India, Thailand, China, Korea, Japan, about their attitudes about moral enhancement, genetic enhancement, cognitive enhancement, and so forth, they're all for it. It's a very tech-open culture, sometimes problematically so. I mean, one of the things about the Abrahamic traditions is at least it's given us a little bit of a questioning of this stuff. I mean, there's kind of an unbridled technophilia on the part of a lot of Asians that I think we could have an interesting dialogue about. There's also a complementarity between the enhancement debate and Buddhism in that Buddhism is first and foremost, it's an insight into the emptiness of false concreteness of every category. And one of the things that you find about a lot of my futurist colleagues who imagine far futures, they want to be there dancing at the end of the universe in their immortal bodies, and they think it's going to be still them, right? So in a billion years, after all the things that they will have had to gone through to survive, they're going to still be Joe. And I have to say to them, in fact, you're not the same Joe that you were yesterday, and you're not going to be the same Joe tomorrow, so you're definitely not going to be the same Joe in a billion years. And the classic case in the kind of science fiction / philosophy, what if you step into a transporter beam and it creates two of you? Which one's the real you? Well, guess what? Neither one is the real you. That's the Buddhist answer, because you didn't exist in the first place. So Buddhism has some interesting answers to this problem of authenticity. It's similarly a problem for the anti-enhancement folks. The anti-enhancement folks say, oh, well, you're not really you when you take Ritalin, or you're not really you when you take Prozac. No, you're just as much you as you were before. You're just a different, you're an evolving you. You're part of a different part of the river. Buddhism also underlines, as I said, this importance of these multiple virtues, which is important. And another aspect of Buddhism is that it is, for me at least, intrinsically both an individual approach to moral enhancement, but also a social approach. The turning of the wheel of the Dharma within Buddhist, one of the ways to understand Buddhism, the turning of the wheel of the Dharma is a social turning and not just an individual turning. It is a social process and not just individual. I'll come back to that. So I often say, how people say to me, oh, how can you be a Buddhist and be for all these enhancement things? What about embracing sickness, aging, and death? Well, the Buddha didn't say if the elephant's swarming down the road at you, you just stand there and say, I embrace sickness, aging, and death. Thwomp. No, that's not the idea at all. You can step out of the way of the elephant. You can take medicine. In fact, monks were supposed to carry medicine with them. For me, it's expressed in the serenity prayer. Give me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change. Okay, so what are the things we cannot change? The courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. So what are the things that we can change now? What are the things that we're going to be able to change in the near future? That's the question I'm raising. Before I get to that, I just want to say, I don't think a pill is the answer to everything. And I think, again, this is a social process. And I point to sniper mindfulness or samurai culture as an example of how things can go so awry. If you extract, you know, just one aspect, and this, we're talking about this now in terms of the popularity of mindfulness meditation in Silicon Valley as a corporate tool, the kind of mindfulness phenomenon. If you extract just one aspect of Buddhism and leave aside all the other virtues and ethics and self-control and so forth, and say, well, we're just going to train you in mindfulness so you can shoot people very efficiently, or you can die an efficient death at the service of the daimyo. Well, that's not really what the whole thing was about. You know, that's not really what the message was originally intended for. So enhancing moral enhancement of the extended mind has to be understood as a transformation of society, making society less violent, not just enabling mindfulness of killing people. So, but we'll come back to that. So this is the model that I want to introduce you to of the ways that I've started to think about the relationship of these different virtues. There's if you go to my website, you can see there's an extensive psychometric set of literature now about how these different kinds of virtues hang together in the way that people assess themselves. It comes out of the positive psychology literature, hundreds of thousands of people taking surveys, assessing their own personal qualities. Also the relationship to psychological attributes. So here we have caring, positivity, so this is happiness basically, intelligence and self-control, and the kind of overlaps that I imagine between these different domains. And this is kind of mapping these onto, you know, Buddhist virtues or Buddhist things that we aspire to. So there's a system of Buddhist virtues called the paramitas, and then there are other terms for other kind of Buddhist states. But self-control, very important in Buddhism, obviously. Caring, we have four terms for compassion, three or four terms for compassion in Buddhist tradition. Different aspects of intelligence, and different ways of understanding happiness or positivity. And then this is the part where the project that I'm engaged in, where I'm trying to say, okay, what is the kind of high-level philosophical way in Buddhism or in the West of understanding the virtues and mapping those out? And what's the relationship to personality attributes that we find in empirical psychology, the five-factor personality model that's become so dominant? Of those five factors, there are four here: agreeableness, lack of neuroticism, openness to experience, and conscientiousness. So, you know, this is the model that when we do all, you know, we crunch thousands and thousands of these different kinds of personality tests, these five factors tend to fall out. And it turns out that about each of these is about 50% genetically determined from twin studies, from genome-wide association studies. And as a consequence, the relationship between these personality characteristics and their related virtues, and then the underlying genetic and neurological basis for why these are genetically determined, allows us to begin to have a conversation about what the neurology of virtue might be and how to understand and map that out. So that's the project that I'm engaged in. I'll just talk briefly here about some of these different virtues and how to understand their potential for enhancement. So the first is self-control and its overlap with mindfulness. And of course, self-control is basic in almost every philosophical and religious tradition. It's not so central to Confucianism, but of course, Confucianism is all about self-control in other ways. But on almost every system, you know, yogic virtues, Buddhist virtues, and so forth, the sila is the basis for the for practicing the Dharma in Buddhism, self-control, prudence, restraint, perseverance. And the personality trait that's closely related to that is called conscientiousness, your ability to follow the rules, basically, to pay attention to the rules. Now, what we know about the neurology of this is that we're born with different degrees of dopaminergic function. So we know that dopaminergic genes are associated with your likelihood to, for instance, be unfaithful to your spouse, to be late to work, to end up in the criminal justice system, to abuse drugs. These are also related to your capacity for executive function, for your prefrontal cortex to basically tell the rest of your brain what to do, to pay attention to things, to have mindfulness. We're born on a bell curve of our capacity for that, and for our, then the personality attributes related to that. And the pathology at this end, ADD or addictions, and then there are folks at this end. And the question is, what might we be able to do to move people up that curve from their natural born state? Well, the first thing, and this is true for almost all the virtues, is that sleep, exercise, diet, absolutely essential. You know, you talk to a college student and they say, I think I may need to take Adderall. Say, well, how much sleep do you get? 3 hours a night. Well, you might try a little bit more sleep, because if you slept a little bit more, you might not need the Adderall. Fine, but some people do benefit from the Adderall anyway, even without the sleep, even after the sleep. Then mindfulness meditation. There's a raft of research being been done on mindfulness meditation at this point. It does everything but shine your shoes. But first, of course, the most important thing is it helps you strengthen your executive function. It actually makes the part of your brain that does executive function bigger, weightier. It allows that part of your brain to tell the rest of your brain more. There are other methods. If you read the self-control literature, cognitive reappraisal. So calling up, if you think, should I eat this hot fudge sundae or not? You think, instead of thinking about how much you really want to eat the hot fudge sundae, you think about next Tuesday when you're going to regret having ate that hot fudge sundae. You cool down the passion of the moment by thinking about future consequences. So there are these kind of techniques. But then there are also these great technologies which we're developing. So neurofeedback for meditation, EEG neurofeedback, being used on soldiers with PTSD to help them to learn meditation. As I mentioned, wearables and self-quantification. I've got a device on here. If you saw pictures from me from a couple years ago, I looked like a very different man. I've lost 45, 50 pounds in the process. And one of the reasons is that I gamified my life by wearing this device on my arm, which tells me moment to moment how many steps I've taken. And these guys, they picked me up today, I was on my treadmill. I put in 50,000 steps on my treadmill yesterday. Now, maybe, in fact, obsessional at this point. David Sedaris wrote a great piece for New Yorker recently about his obsession with getting his steps on into his Fitbit. But it is for me. I do want to get those steps in. And the wearables allow us to exert, to know, not lie to ourselves about what we're actually doing, and actually then try to control that behavior. Stimulant drugs, as I said, are substantially helpful for these, for having this kind of self-control, for improving executive function. But we've also got specific treatments for compulsions and addictions, which are becoming increasingly effective. Testosterone suppression for sex offenders has a very strong effect on the recidivism. Alcohol aversion drugs, opiate replacement, and the possibility of vaccines and gene therapies that will turn off your brain's response to particular kinds of drugs. Safer drugs, drugs that the persistent hope, of course, morphine was invented as a cure for opiate addiction, and heroin was invented as a cure for morphine addiction, so hope springs eternal here, but the hope is that eventually we're gonna come up with something that kills pain but doesn't get you addicted to it. At least with alcohol, we can probably do that. And then, one of the things that turns out to happen with folks that exercise or who take SSRIs is that they grow new neurons, and the growing of new neurons in your brain actually allows your brain to reconfigure and overcome certain kinds of addictions, neurogenesis. So figuring out how to stimulate neurogenesis may allow us to exert more control, self-control. Caring. So the virtues, compassion, generosity, empathy, so forth. The personality trait, agreeableness. And there are two basic things to understand here. The first is that we have an innate mammalian capacity to respond to other people's and other mammals' pain, to other mammals' experience. The contagiousness of yawns, the seeing somebody step on a nail and feeling that and actually having that part of your brain light up. That's emotional contagion. That's mirror neurons, the capacity to have that kind of emotional response. But then, because we grew these big prefrontal cortices, we also developed the capacity to imagine what's going on in somebody else's head, what their motivations are, what their feelings are, to have cognitive empathy. So these are two very different kinds of empathy. First, we have this innate kind, most of us do, and then we develop this cognitive kind. Now, there's a predisposition for our capacities for both, and there are characteristic deficits. So autism is a deficit, principally, of cognitive empathy, the ability to form that theory of somebody else's mind, and psychopathy is principally a deficit of emotive empathy, the ability to see what somebody else is experiencing but not feel it personally yourself. I keep touching this. Sorry, I'm banging on my mic. And the research that's gone on about the neurotransmitters that are related to these different personality traits or moral sentiments, testosterone seems to be related to aggression, although one great experiment surreptitiously dosed women with testosterone, but didn't tell them that they were being dosed with testosterone, and dosed another group of women and told them they were being dosed with testosterone. And the women who were dosed with testosterone acted more aggressively. And the women who were dosed with testosterone and weren't told they were being dosed, they acted more cooperatively. So who knows? The data may still be out on testosterone, but it seems like testosterone is related to aggression. Oxytocin increases cooperation and trust, also makes them more racist, because it increases cooperation and trust with your friends and people like you, makes you more xenophobic towards people not like you, so maybe not the thing that we want to give everybody right away. But we're beginning to understand some of the moral psychology here, and that at least if someone had a deficit, so autism, for instance, it turns out that autists appear to be responsive to oxytocin, to giving them this cuddle hormone, appears to help them recognize emotions on other people's faces. So even if it makes them a little bit more racist, that's probably, you know, in the end, a good thing. There are other therapies, computer entrainment for emotion recognition. So having kind of flashcard system, what is this face saying, what is this face saying? And you can train people with cognitive empathy deficits to recognize emotions better. Loving kindness meditation is being researched, and it's showing that loving kindness meditation has a systematic effect on improving empathy. Now, intelligence. Intellectual virtues are, again, a part of most systems. Wisdom, the love of learning, having a capacity for good decision making, having a tolerance for ambiguity. And within Buddhism, you know, the Eightfold Path, right understanding. We post-hippie antinomian Buddhists, Anglo-Buddhists, we have generally an anti-intellectual approach, you know, just sit on the cushion and that's just shut up. But no, Buddhism has a long scholastic tradition, and understanding things appropriately is very clearly a part of the Buddhist tradition. And it turns out that there is a personality trait, openness to experience, which is closely related to intellectual capacities. It's correlated with IQ. And that the genetic variation in general IQ, G, and in openness to experience is significant, 50, 60, 70%, depending on the cognitive capacity. So here's a map, 45% of temporal lobe capacities, 75% of visual cortex, and so forth. And so people have different abilities on the basis of these inherent capacities. And what we're hoping is that we will come up with capacities, ways of enhancing intelligence and other all the different kinds of cognitive capacities. We know that, again, exercise, sleep, and diet, very good for intelligence, memory. Education in general is good for increasing your what's particularly called crystallized intelligence. Bilingualism, people who are bilingual tend to have more cognitive capacity. Musical training. Mindfulness meditation, again, seems to be good for this. But also, we're developing what we call the exocortex. We're developing a system of devices, laptops, cell phones, tablets, the Google itself, which is, you know, I feel pretty stupid when I don't have access to Google. I mean, I don't know if you've had the experience of having an argument with someone and said, why are we arguing about this? In 2 seconds, we can know the answer, right? There's no reason to have an argument about this particular topic anymore. All the world's knowledge is at our fingertips at this point. We're now embedded in knowledge in ways that we weren't before, which is a cognitive enhancement. Delaying aging. So some of the most exciting, the CLOTO gene, has been discovered, which not only has an effect of delaying aging and extending life of rodents, but it also improves their cognitive function along the way. I think we would all like that particular thing to come about, so living longer and having more faculties as we do so. Brain-machine interfaces. Now, again, the data is still out on how effective these are, but now there are consumer versions for $200. You can get a machine, this machine right here, which will zap your brain, literally zap your brain from the outside with electricity, and is supposed to help you learn, help you remember by putting small amounts of electricity through your brain. I don't recommend this experiment yet because the data is still definitely out on this. There's a study that just came out yesterday that it increases mind wandering, which for some, certainly not for a Buddhist, a good idea, therefore. But we're going to continually understand the brain better. We're going to get these devices smaller and smaller and fit them inside the head. And we're going to have gene therapies, or we have this effective gene therapy technology now, CRISPR, which will allow us to change our own biology and those of our children. Fairness, quickly. Fairness has a lot to do with the balance between the prefrontal cortex and the amygdala. The amygdala is that part of your brain that tells you about disgust and fear. And I don't know how many of you have ever seen John Haidt's model of moral intuition. So we're born as mammals with moral intuitions, these five moral intuitions that Haidt's pointed to: harm, fairness, in-group, authority, and purity. So harm is don't hurt another monkey. Fairness is share the bananas well. In-group authority is always go with the tribe. You know, don't trust the outsiders. Authority is respect the alpha male, and purity is poo is stinky. That's why you only use it to throw in an argument. So these are deeply embedded moral sentiments that we have, which bubble up from our amygdala and tell our brain what's good and what's bad. And the prefrontal cortex then has to make a decision about whether to accept those conclusions or not. And it turns out that this means that there are liberal and conservative brains. We exist on a continuum of liberal and conservative brains. Politics, our politics at this level, is genetically determined, strongly genetically influenced. And so we can see ways of changing that balance. Now, this is going to sound incredibly partisan of me, but basically, liberals are folks who have stronger prefrontal cortices. If you go out, before you go out drinking, you're more liberal. When you drink, you turn out to be more conservative. If your IQ is correlated with liberal versus conservative politics, every single measure, when you're sleepy, you're more conservative than when you're fully awake, okay? So every single measure of the strength of relationship between your prefrontal cortex and your amygdala shows that the stronger your amygdala is in relationship to your prefrontal cortex, the more liberal you're gonna be. So, sorry if that sounds partisan, but it is. That's what Stephen Colbert says, reality has a liberal tilt to it. Theory of mind training is one of the ways that we can improve our capacity for, well, theory of mind training also goes back to this cognitive empathy, so literature, virtual reality. There are fairness technologies, which I have EG here, that's very helpful. But fairness technologies are things like, if you, Dan Ariely, the economist, he has a software called Conscience, and it has about 50 different decisions that you might have to make, and it has five arguments for each. Now, I don't find it terribly useful myself, but if you wanted to try to think through some decisions, it might be a useful exercise, at least, to do this. So, you know, if you wanted to say, should I cheat on my taxes? What are the five arguments for and what are the five arguments against? Have a kind of detached fairness exercise around those things, this kind of mindful distancing of biases. And the most research that's been done on this is around things like implicit bias training for cops or doctors. We know that our amygdala is telling us, you know, white woman with a gun, do you shoot? Black man with a gun, do you shoot? Hispanic with a gun, do you shoot? Even those of us who say, I'm not a racist, who actually have never expressed a racist thing in our life, many of us, when we're in that kind of situation being tested in that way, we see the black man with the gun, we're split second more likely to want to shoot. Split second more likely to want to do harm. And that's because of these implicit biases that we carry around with us. Now, how do we overcome that? What's the training to overcome that? And it's slowing down the process. It's allowing the neocortex, the prefrontal cortex, to have more time to make that evaluation and not have the amygdala and the hind parts of our brain make that decision for us. And those turn out to be effective. Now, propranolol is a drug for high blood pressure. And it turns out that one of the effects that it has is that if you take it when you're in a stressful situation like public speaking, it suppresses the fight or flight reflex so that your heart's not beating so fast, you don't feel the shortness of breath and so forth. And as a consequence, violinists find it very helpful for performance, but it also reduces racism. Now, why does it do that? It's because it damps down amygdalic responses. So you see two dudes kissing, you see the black man on the street, you see somebody wearing an abaya or a headscarf, and you have this immediate emotional reaction, or do you have the calmness to say, well, I shouldn't really be afraid, I don't need to be freaked out, this is okay, everything's okay, right? And propranolol allows that to take place. What we need is something a little bit more effective and long-lasting than propranolol. And again, what Haidt found was that liberals tend to have more fairness, or tend to express fairness and harm care as the basis of their moral decision making, and hardly express these three amygdalic responses at all. Well, they're all amygdalic to an extent, but that the conservatives were much more likely to express in-group loyalty, respect for authority, and purity and sanctity. It's a very powerful model. And these, again, turn out to be substantially genetic. Happiness. Now, as I said, happiness, positivity, is a virtue, but it's also the end of virtue. And so the question is, how do we understand this? We want to be happy. We don't want to be like Mother Teresa, ending up just spending our entire life in self-sacrifice and never being happy. So happiness has to be a part of the good life. But we also want to have more meaning to our life than just, you know, pizza, 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 and ice cream, and sex, and methamphetamine. So there has to be something more to it, right? Now, there are also two very different personality traits that are related to these different kinds of happiness, happiness as pleasure and happiness as flourishing. It turns out that neuroticism, the personality trait of neuroticism, again, 50% determined, is the principal determinant of moment-to-moment happiness. But if you ask somebody, not are you happy right now, but how do you feel about your life? That's a different question. It turns out that older people are mostly thinking about that. Younger people tend to be happier on a moment to moment than older people. Older people, looking back over the course of their life, maybe sometimes through complete fictional recreation of their life, but they're looking back over the course of their life, they have more to be happy about in that respect. And they say, I'm more content with the things that I've accomplished. And so there's two very, you know, you ask, are you happy to these two people? They're answering on the basis of two entirely different things. And it turns out that the personality traits that support flourishing have mostly to do with self-control. Your capacity for self-control is what predicts your ending up with the kind of life where you feel proud of what you've accomplished, right? A flourishing life. But your capacity for neuroticism is what determines whether you're happy moment to moment. Two very different things. And there are two very different things that lead to them. There are different kinds of practices. So an example here is having children. Children make you miserable moment to moment. You look at the moment to moment happiness of young adults, and as soon as they have children, it goes boom, and they're unhappy until the kids leave home, and then they're happy again. But you ask people about whether they think they've accomplished anything with their life, and people who have had children tend to answer, now I'm not saying, this is entirely sociological, right? So whether you think that you need a job, whether you think you need children to accomplish something with your life is entirely psychological, sociological. But in our society, most people with children feel better about that aspect of their life than those who didn't. So these are two very different kinds of accomplishment. But marriage, participation in communities of meaning, gratitude diaries, compassion meditation, ways to enhance flourishing, exercise, sleep, diet, sex, and so forth. And again, we probably will come up with very effective mood modifiers that will increase moment-to-moment mood, and that we'll have to figure out what's the difference with enhancing flourishing. What kinds of things enhance flourishing as opposed to, this is the derogatory sci-fi term, wireheading. We don't want a wirehead. We don't want to be walking around with just the happiness wire on. We want a flourishing life. I am winding down here. I know I'm using up all my time, but this is my last virtue. Transcendence, and this is the hardest one, because transcendence is it's an amorphous category. But the way I'm using it here is the idea that there are certain kinds of experiences, and I think Buddhism is as opposed to the Abrahamic religions, emphasizes this much more heavily. There are certain kinds of experiences which allow you to peek outside of the ego tunnel, to peek outside of the trap of seeing reality as solid and unflexible. And those experiences, again, personality types, it turns out the people who are, have open, high openness to experience are much more likely to be hypnotized, to be susceptible to mystical experiences, to call themselves spiritual as opposed to religious. Openness to experience, which is also correlated with IQ and politics, but let's not get too partisan again. So openness to experience. And so we're a capacity for having that kind of experience where we peek outside of these habitual ways of looking at things. This is something that we want to encourage. And there are tools that we know that do this, experiences we know, peak experiences, altered states of consciousness. And one of the things that's common to these is neurologically, when we look at what's happening, there are certain parts of our brain that are responsible for saying, your body ends here. We know that if some people have disorders of body awareness, they can think, my body actually ends here, and this floppy thing at the end of my arm, that's not really part of me. Cut it off, doc, I don't want it anymore. Or conversely, that you can have the phantom limb syndrome, which is my body continues out to here, and that's not actually here anymore. That part of your brain, the proprioceptive part of your brain, you can turn that off. You can turn it off with meditation, you can turn it off with drugs, and you can turn it off with focused magnets. And when that happens, boom, there's no boundaries to your body. You feel oneness with the things around you. The part of your brain that's tracking time is a specific part of your brain. You can turn that off and suddenly have the experience of timelessness. And the parts of your brain which are constantly labeling, saying, well, I'm looking at a person, a human being in this room, I'm situated 10 feet from me, you can turn that off and have a completely ineffable experience, an experience beyond words. And we know that there are various things that do this, chanting, dance, trances. We know that lucid dreaming turns out, lucid dreaming is related, by the way, back to executive function. People who lucid dream turn out to have stronger executive function. Lucid dreaming is when you wake up in your dream and recognize that you're dreaming. And then you can say, well, okay, if I'm dreaming, let's fly. Boom. People can learn how to do this, and we're developing tools to teach ourselves how to do it. It will recognize when you go into REM sleep and give you a slight, you know, bing or, you know, a smell or something. And you, when you recognize that in your dream, you say, oh, this isn't really happening. I'm just in a dream. And then you can go into the dream state. So that kind of exploration of alternate states of consciousness. Within Buddhism, the absorptive jhanic meditation practices, but also psychedelics, which are experiencing this enormous renaissance in research, psilocybin in particular, but MDMA and even LSD, although it's got a bad rap. Lasting experiences of increase in the psychological attribute of openness. Up to 6 months after people take one dose of psilocybin, their personality trait, and this is the only time we ever see, you know, with SSRIs, yes, if you continue taking SSRIs, you can change that neuroticism thing. But one dose of psilocybin can have a lasting effect up to 6 months in changing people's sense of openness. Transcranial magnetic stimulation, which I mentioned, focusing magnets on different parts of the brain to temporarily dampen their function. This is, by the way, this is a picture published last year of functional magnetic resonance imaging summarized as a two-dimensional image of the effect of psilocybin. This is the brain before psilocybin, and this is the brain after psilocybin, and all the functional connections that open up between different parts of the brain once you're on psilocybin. So those are the virtues I'm working with, and my model is, again, not one of doing each one separately or doing each one depending on which one you think you're worst at. I think, as all the traditions recommend, we have to cultivate all of these virtues simultaneously. Each of them has something to say to the other. Each of them tempers and balances the other in an integrated process of character development. And I think the most complicated thing for me as a sociologist to think about is what it means to take seriously the notion that we are not selves, that we are extended selves, that we are embedded selves. This is Indra's net, which comes from Mahayana, but it's similar to the, or related to the Theravadan concept of Pratityasamutpada, or the codependent origination. We do not exist as a thing separately from everything else. We all arise simultaneously. We define each other simultaneously. If we were to have moral enhancement, it can't just be one person morally enhancing by themselves in Abu Ghraib without doing something about Abu Ghraib. So how do we encourage moral enhancement in liberal democratic societies? You know, ISIS wants to encourage moral enhancement. The Iranian government has a Department of Moral Enhancement. That's one of the reasons why we get anxious about the notion of any kind of social policy flowing from the idea of virtue, because one person's virtue may be not the same as another's. What does it mean to have a concept of flourishing that can be applied in a liberal democratic society? This brings us to the final point, cognitive liberty. What we need to do is have this conversation. We're going to have these technologies. We're going to have these capacities to improve our various moral capacities beyond even the norm and up to the extraordinary. And how do we define people's rights? We already have a debate over Asperger's rights. So I said Asperger's syndrome or autism is a disability of cognitive empathy. But there are lots of people with Asperger's who say, no, I'm more intelligent than you are because I'm not being distracted all the time by all you people's emotions. I can see things clearly. And okay, well, we have to have that conversation then. Criminal rehabilitation and psychiatric treatment. There was a time in the Soviet Union when anybody who had a disagreement with the government was automatically insane, and then you threw them in a psychiatric treatment facility. At the same time, I don't know if you've seen Clockwork Orange recently, but for me, Clockwork Orange is not at all a sympathetic portrayal of this poor guy who was brutalized by the state. This guy deserved it. And whatever, you know, the treatment may have been a little unusual by our current standards, but if it gets him not to brutalize people anymore, it might have been a good idea. So the question is, what's the difference between testosterone suppression for sex criminals and throwing ideological prisoners in jail? Now, when do we make that distinction between those two with these kinds of things? Sisyphus drugs, I'll just stop on that. Sisyphus drug is the idea, Sisyphus is rolling the stone up the hill. That poor Sisyphus, what if we could give him a drug where he really loves rolling that stone up that hill, right? Wouldn't that be great? You know, you just go to work every day. Is that flourishing, right? I don't know. We have to have that conversation. Thank you very much.
I'm sure questions will be fun.
Sure.
Loud enough so
that you can hear. Have you heard of Nietzschean Buddhism at all?
Yes.
Okay, because they all sound like what you were talking about. This sounds very much like Nietzschean Buddhism. So what would you say about that?
Well, Nietzschean Buddhism is certainly more goal-oriented. I'd say Nietzschean Buddhism is still pretty much a thing in flux. It's a newest dispensation. It's probably more open to some of these ideas than others. Just to take a step back, I think every religion is going to have to come to an accommodation with these possibilities. And there is within Mormonism now, there's a Mormon Transhumanist Association, and they see all these promises of immortality, of the ability to radically transform the body as a fulfillment of Mormon prophecy. I see the Nichiren Buddhists as kind of the Mormons of Buddhism, because they're the latest dispensation with their own prophets and a different understanding of history than the rest of Buddhists have. But as a consequence, they've been somewhat more creative, because the rest of Buddhists are weighted down by 2,000 years of history. So maybe Nichiren will be able to accommodate these things more quickly, just like the Mormons have. Yeah.
So many questions, but I think this is the last. Are you a materialist in terms of the brain? And related to that, in terms of enlightenment, complete liberation, and including some people who have experienced or say they've
I am a materialist, I'm sad to say, if it disappoints anyone. But yes, I don't believe in reincarnation, the classical theory of karma doesn't do much for me, et cetera, et cetera. And yes, I think if enlightenment means something, it's something that happens in the brain. However, as a futurist of a broad mind, when my kids used to ask, are there unicorns, I would say, not yet, you know? And that's what I say about reincarnation. We don't have reincarnation yet, but we're going to pretty soon, I think, because we're going to be able to, you know, send little nanobots throughout our brains, record everything that's going on in there, and upload it to computers and do all kinds of stuff. So yes, if you want to live on in different bodies, that's probably going to happen. So in some respects, I think Buddhism is, in that respect as well, is a more compatible religion with these kind of neurotechnological possibilities in the future. Now, whether enlightenment is something, again, I don't believe, you know, that like our brains are quantum processors and somehow tapping into the great unknown when we achieve enlightenment. I don't believe that. But I do think we'll be able to determine there are specific processes in the brain that happen when someone experiences Kensho or Satori or whatever that particular kind of experience we're talking about. And there are people who are doing that research. Kenneth Vago? Anybody know? I forget his first name. But anyway, look up Vago, V-A-G-O, a neurologist who's been doing great research with a Zen teacher. And they've been teaching people four different meditation techniques and then doing fMRI studies of what's happening in their brain. And these are all very advanced meditators. And so they're able to see very specifically what different jhanic states look like neurologically and map out which particular things are being turned on and turned off. One of the things I didn't mention, the default mode network, the kind of default network for the way that we pay attention to things, this turns out to be suppressed. You know, there's certain parts of the brain that are lit up and other parts that are suppressed. And as I said, this is what gives us some of these experiences, oneness, timelessness, and so forth, occurs when some of these traditional functions of the brain are suppressed. So I think we will have an increasing understanding of that, yeah. Yes. So if we can jack up everybody's fairness, then maybe we can have a more equal, fair society. It turns out that there are actual neurological differences between Scandinavians and the rest of us. There are certain serotonin genes that are more common in Scandinavia. And so some people have even suggested that Scandinavian social democracy was enabled by them having these genes. We'll see if that ever pans out. But at any rate, I do think, yes, we need a more fair society. One of the ways I think about that is that the first place that this is going to impact us is that we're facing the retirement of the baby boomers and a declining fertility rate. And this is creating this imbalance between growing numbers of older people and shrinking numbers of younger people. And we're going to be having not only these cognitive enhancement technologies, we're going to be having these life extension technologies, which are going to allow people to live longer and longer. So right now, if you don't have access to life insurance, or to health insurance, rather, it probably means a difference of 5 years. You know, people who are billionaires don't live that much longer than everybody else. But people at the bottom of society definitely, you know, have a deficit of life expectancy compared to those at the top. But when that becomes 2 decades, 3 decades, 4 decades, 5 decades, the moral imperative becomes stronger and stronger to remedy that. So I think there's going to be a strong political movement about universal access to basic health care, life extension technology. Now, the degree to which you include these kinds of moral enhancement technologies, I think first depends on whether we can get past the therapy versus enhancement distinction. So, Europeans don't like how many American kids are on ADD drugs. I was diagnosed with ADD in first grade and was on them until I was 14. And thank goodness it started in the 60s, because if I had been that kind of kid in the 40s, I would have been a bad kid. You know, the kids with those kinds of behaviors were just bad kids or bad apples. My son, they used to have to rope him off in his own corner of kindergarten. And when he led so many girls into the bathrooms to play doctor, they took the doors off of the bathroom to try to solve that particular problem. When my brother actually, filled his bedroom wall full of arrow holes because he used it as an arrow range, the first question my mother would ask us is, did you take your pill? because that was the first moral decision we had to make every particular day. So anyway, what was your question again? I don't know.
Increasing inequality.
So ADD, it's a very good example. There's a strong debate about whether we're overdiagnosing or underdiagnosing. And it's very clear that in affluent white communities, there are some communities where 50% of kids are taking ADD medications or have the diagnosis. And there are some African-American communities where kids have a lot of problems, where only 5%, 3% are getting those diagnoses and those treatments. So there is a tangible effect of inequality of access to moral enhancement. Let's not, well, maybe not call it moral enhancement, but these kinds of drugs and therapies. There's a tangible inequality of access to mental health treatments, which has a consequence of who ends up in the criminal justice system and who doesn't. So these are already questions with us, and they will become ever more acute as the drugs and treatments get better. Well, there's this question of what's too much of all of these things? You know, is there a golden mean for each of these things, the Buddhist middle way for each of these things? There seems to be for everything but self-control. No one's ever shown that too much self-control leads to anything really bad. You know, you can imagine that maybe someone who has too much self-control is never spontaneous enough, wouldn't be that much fun at a party. But in terms of self-control, it's correlated with getting a lover, getting married, holding a job, making money, you know, any positive thing you can relate it to. But the others, you can have too much agreeableness. You can be so agreeable. There's Willems syndrome, I think it's called. It's a form of cognitive disability where people have the incapacity to distrust others. And they become very vulnerable. So too much agreeableness, too low a neuroticism, the inability to. So what does it mean to be too happy? People who are happy, everything is positive for people who are happier, happier, happier until you get to the top 2% or so. When you get to that top 2%, they make less money, they vote less, they get less education. Why? Because they're happy. They don't need to do any of that stuff, right? They get up, what do I need to do that for? I'm already really happy. So the question is, where is the golden mean to be found on each of these curves, and how do we set it? But I think your question about cat videos raises this other question, which is, if we just allow people to choose which of the things that they enhance, are they just going to enhance their capacity to stay up all night watching cat videos and not enhance any of the virtues? And so how do we create a social norm that says, really, you should spend a little bit more time on the opera and a little bit less on the cat videos? I mean, this is John Stuart Mill's response to his own utilitarian education, which was Bentham, his mentor, said, more or less, that it's fine if you decide that what makes you happiest in life is just lying in the gutter taking heroin, then that's what makes you happier. That's the pleasure, that's the summum bonum. And John Stuart Mill said, no, I think actually we can probably put a stronger thumb on the scale for going to the opera and reading a good novel than just taking the heroin, even if it means, tilting the calculus a little bit. And that's the kind of norm that we have to encourage, and we already do. I mean, who can go to school, secular or religious, and not be exposed to civic norms that say you should vote? You should take a couple minutes of your day and go vote, or you should help your neighbor across the street or whatever. We have these norms already. But the question is, when does that set of norms become so restrictive that it violates our normative freedom? And I don't know, that's for debate.
Distribution, I guess,
Well, there's so much to say there. The first thing is that corruption is one of the strongest sociological predictors of people's happiness with their own lives and with their societies. So basically, your trust in institutions. Do you think that you live in a fair society? When the people think that their society is not corrupt, they tolerate more inequality than when they think it's corrupt. Maybe that's bad, but at any rate, it has a strong relationship to happiness. And we do a lot of things to try to look at try to understand and judge the moral probity of people in public life. And a lot of that has to do with their personal behavior. So Clinton's scandal, or Dominique Strauss-Kahn, one of the leaders of the French Socialist Party, who's recently been caught up in sex scandals. People like that, you know, you think, if you didn't have enough self-control not to hang out with all those prostitutes and take all those drugs, then, you know, do you really have enough self-control to be an effective agent of my interests in public life? And maybe that's not the best question. You know, maybe people can be really crappy husbands and have really out of control personal lives and still be really good politicians, but we're looking for some way to judge that. And I think one of the things that this raises is, just as we try to determine the religious orientations of people. So for instance, atheists, fewer people in the United States would vote for an atheist for public life than for a Muslim. You know, great, good on the Muslims, I guess. But you know, it's because atheists are supposedly self-confessed people with no moral code, right? And why would you want to put someone like that in public life? And that's a really bad way to judge whether people are going to be good agents of your interest in public life. So I think when we get to the point where there's strong and effective neurotechnological means of understanding people's, of controlling people's behavior, it's probably going to be one of the things that you have to disclose, just like your taxes. And yeah, I'm taking the John Stuart Mill operating system, and you know, I had the moral enhancement treatment last year, and you can talk to the doctor, here's my records. So yeah, it may be one of those things. I mean, we want to know about the psychiatric history of people in public life as well. I mean, that's relevant for decision making. So I think it's going to be complicated how it plays out. But clearly, yes, the integrity of our public institutions is related to the personal behavior and moral integrity of the leaders.
Building on that and the comment before about inequality, would you like to talk about our initiative on the type of comparison?
He works for me. yeah, so we've been, for 10, 12 years, we've been a part of this futurist community, and there are two big political factions within this futurist community we're part of, the libertarians and those of us on the left. And those of us on the left are finally said, enough is enough. And we got together in Paris in November and issued a statement called the Techno-Progressive Declaration about how we want to encourage a political intervention on the part of egalitarians who foresee the possibility of these technologies. And so we're different from a lot of people on the left, because a lot of people on the left are like, ooh, genetic engineering and nanotechnology and artificial intelligence, a bunch of corporate, you know, they're technophobic. And a lot of people in the techno community are technophilic, uncritically. So we're trying to carve out this space, and you'll see a lot about this kind of a perspective at the IET, this techno-progressive perspective of how you can be for an egalitarian, free society that is also a high-tech one and that enables people to use these technologies. So yes, thank you, Chris. We're working on that project. Yes?
One or two more questions. I'm wondering, what do you see as the future of psychedelic drug research and how it relates to existential depression and inducing mystical experiences?
Well, one of the avenues, as you've noticed, is working with people who are dying, who have terminal cancer, other diseases, and it turns out that psilocybin and probably other drugs as well, other psychedelic drugs, allow them, it actually dampens the activity in the amygdala, their existential fear that they feel about dying, partly by giving them these peaks at these experiences, which they often interpret as supernatural, the possibility of afterlife existence, things like this. You know, whether, you know, that, again, I don't believe in those things, but for whatever reason, These experiences appear to relieve existential dread of people who are facing death. And of course, it'd be nice, since we're all facing death, one way or the other, be nice for us all to be able to have a little bit of that, to have a little bit of that peak. I mean, a lot of us 60s era Buddhists, I mean, I got exposed to Buddhism in 1974, so right after the 60s. And a lot of us took acid, you know, and did yoga in the front yard for a couple hours, and you know. And these were the kinds of experiences that led us to then want to go on meditation retreats and deepen that. Now, I don't think, and in fact, on the front page of Tricycle Magazine's website today, they republished an article, a long dialogue between Zen master and a psychologist about the efficacy of psychedelics as a part of a Buddhist spiritual practice. And a remarkably open dialogue, because a lot of meditation teachers are totally icked out by the idea. But I think the reality is that a lot of us of that era, that was our first peak, that there was a way to look at things and then might want to do that through meditation instead of through taking drugs all the time.
Yeah. I have a question about the Sisyphus drugs. And is this a specter we should worry about in terms of corporate interests in capitalist society, which, you know, it's very useful to get people to want to go to work happy and yet be basically just cogs in a kind of capitalist machine. Is that like a big specter that your institute is looking at, or I mean, how does, can you speak more about that?
Sure. Well, so this is part of the critique of people who are skeptical of stimulant medication for kids and for adults. And there's a drug, modafinil, which allows you to, which is not a stimulant medication, but allows you to work, you know, 16 hours a day without any ill effect, and is very popular on Wall Street. So, yes, I mean, this is the question. So what do we do about that? So there's been moves to restrict the number of hours that medical interns should work because they make bad decisions when they work too long. And I think it's good to have those kind of laws, and it's good to have an 8-hour workday, and it's good to have force people to be paid overtime, and so forth. If people make that decision, how do we, you know, what kind of laws could we have, or what kinds of restrictions could we have that would keep them from doing that? So Americans, unfortunately, compared to Europeans and people in a lot of the rest of the world, they prefer to work over having leisure, and that's just our social norm. And it's also the weakness of our social safety net. If we make some of these things available, it's going to enable that workerist culture. Now, the other thing I could say is that workerist culture may not be around very long because robots are going to take over a lot of the jobs. People are going to probably have to adapt to doing less work inevitably in the future. But yes, I think we have to worry about that. There are other kinds of contexts. What if we allow soldiers to be doped up with medication that keeps them from ever experiencing PTSD because they never remember in an emotional way the things that they do in war? What kinds of moral consequences, what kinds of foreign policy consequences is that going to have? It might be better to just send drones and robots in than to have soldiers who could make mistakes and never even feel it. So I think there are moral complications here in a lot of domains. But the difference between a Luddite and a non-Luddite is the Luddite says the way to solve a social problem is to ban a technology, right? The way to solve patriarchy is to ban sex selective abortion. Well, no, I don't know. I think allowing women to control their own bodies probably trumps that particular one. The way to solve unemployment of textile workers is to smash up textile machines, the original Luddite cause, no. The way to solve unemployment is to create an unemployment compensation system for your society and to tax employers and pay for that system. So the way to solve a lot of these problems is not to ban the particular technology, I think. It's to create a fairer society. Is that?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah.